And today I'm here to tell you about somebody who was twice named to Forbes' list of 30 people under 30 doing great things in education, who also touched a large number of people in the world, Andrew Sutherland, founder and CTO of Quizlet.com. Andrew started Quizlet in 2005 from his high school for his high school French class course to do better in French 3. And let's see how much better his French is today, maybe. But Quizlet quickly spread to his classmates and beyond, and beyond means the rest of the world. He came to MIT, and while studying computer science here and also doing a minor in education along the side, Andrew was quietly growing Quizlet in the best of traditions from his dorm room. How many here are from East Campus? Ah, a handful of folks. The best place of all to do this from. So he left MIT after an incredible 3 years to continue to pursue Quizlet full-time, and his platform is now touching 20 million students and teachers each month, which is a pretty awesome rate. I mean, 20 million people, you're really soon on your way to touching 100 million people, not even in 10 years, but rather in 1 year, maybe even faster. So this is the story of Andrew Sutherland. Please join me in giving a hand to Andrew and welcoming him here.
Thank you. I'm really, really excited to be here. What I want to talk about today is empowering students and teachers. And what I mean by that is giving them tools that help them learn, giving them things that don't just sort of instruct them or teach at them, but give them sort of the tools and capabilities for them to create their own content, to explore whatever they're learning. And so that's what I'm going to focus on. So just to give a little background on me, this is a great introduction, and the company. So Quizlet is a company I founded. Quizlet's mission is to help students practice and master whatever they're learning. So we provide a bunch of tools that students put whatever curriculum they're learning into Quizlet. So you know, we have veterinary students using it. We have you know, my high school French class. We have you know, seventh grade history classes. We have lots of medical school students. We have a very broad range of users on the platform, and that's because we empower students and teachers to put whatever they're learning onto the platform rather than sort of having a fixed curriculum that we sort of teach out. So the brief background, this is me with my high school French teacher, Ms. Selvin, and the backstory is I started it because one night she assigned us 111 French animals that we needed to learn in two nights, and there are lots of crazy ones on there, like black European grass snake, la couleuvre, and despite that sounding a little crazy, she was an amazing teacher. She would really get us to use a lot of the things that we were learning in class. So we would learn these words, and then we'd use them in essays, in skits that we wrote, in dialogues. So she gave us all this work, but also got us to apply it. And so for me, I was building this, I was studying for this test, and I was getting my dad to quiz me, and it was not very effective. And so what I decided to build, I had a little bit of programming knowledge. I'd done some JavaScript before. And so I built a really, really simple tool that would just take in the whole list. It would it would show a question, and it would make me type in the answer, and it would keep track of them all and make sure I got them all right. And that I could actually reproduce them, not just sort of say that I could. And with that tool, I got 100% on my next test, which I had never done before, and I thought that was really cool. And I shared it with a few friends in that class. They all started getting much better grades. And you know, I basically just kept working on it. I wasn't really thinking about starting a company or starting, you know, the next big startup. I was just basically building it for myself and my friends. And it wasn't until later that I sort of had the idea that this could be a real business. And also I was building it very much for myself. So you know, it was the school of product philosophy, I guess, that if you can empathize with your users as much as possible, you'll build a better product. And so for myself, Quizlet was for me. And so I was, you know, I would be studying, I would realize that there was a problem with Quizlet because I was using it, or some question could be asked better, some workflow could be better, and I would put my books aside and code it. I would probably live push it to the server because we only had like 10 users then, and then I would use it and see if it was better and then sort of go from there. And so it was this sort of very close iteration cycle where I was just, you know, building for myself. So after a few years of working on it in high school, I went to MIT. I discovered Fall. I came from California. And I spent 3 years here doing computer science and spent some time on speech recognition, had a ton of fun here. Leaving MIT was probably one of the hardest things I've ever done because I had such a good time here. And the students here, the professors, the whole community is so creative and smart, and it was such a fertile environment for me. And so, but what I realized was Quizlet was growing really quickly. I think we had about 1 million monthly users at that point. And to me, it was sort of a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to pursue this thing that seemed like it could become a really big thing. So I decided to jump for that and moved to San Francisco and started Quizlet as more of a business. So before, it was sort of a side project that I was working on while doing my PSATs and stuff. And so now Quizlet is 55 employees. As of this morning, we are the number 27th largest website in the US, which I think is pretty awesome. We're used by 33% of all US high school students every month, and we have 20 million monthly active users. We're about 85% in the US right now. One of the big things we're working on is expanding internationally. So we'll be sort of growing from there. The other couple fun things, we celebrated 2 weeks ago the 10th anniversary of Quizlet launching in 2007. So I'm really proud of that. And about a year ago, for the first time, we raised money. So we were bootstrapped for 10 years and did not take any money from VCs. And very recently, we decided that we could go much faster and be much more ambitious about the learning impact that we wanted to have in the world, and so we raised money. So that's just sort of setting up for the main thing I want to talk about, which is sort of the broader business of education technology and where it's been, where it's going, a lot of the flaws, a lot of the failures. There are a lot of failures. I'll talk about that. And then I do have some hope for sort of the next few years and the changes that have happened recently that I think will make it easier to build education businesses, to scale up tools, stuff like that. So last week, Pearson, Washington Post had an article. Pearson, which is the world's largest education company, they laid off 10% of their workforce. Their stock dropped 10% or 20%. It's down 75% since 2000. They fired their CEO also a couple weeks ago. It's not looking good for them. They're, I would say, the most progressive, or the one that's of the publishers in education, they've been the ones that have tried to sort of push into the digital age the fastest and arguably most successfully, and they're also struggling. Another great example, Amplify, which was a project of Rupert Murdoch of Fox News, Wall Street Journal, News Corp fame. And he decided that the time was now to disrupt education and build a giant business in it. In 2010, he hired the star celebrity ex-New York City schools chancellor, Joel Klein, as the CEO of his company. And what they wanted to build was a complete solution for schools. So they built a whole digital curriculum with Common Core. They built this whole analytics platform that would track all the student progress. They even built their own tablets with custom hardware that they designed and made themselves, which is crazy. And so they tried it out. They rolled it out at a few districts. They had all this promise. They were really excited about it. But no one really bought it. No one really cared. It had where they did roll it out, there were a bunch of problems, you know, with like basic stuff of like the tablets couldn't turn on, or they didn't have enough like Wi-Fi bandwidth to like have all the kids on at the same time, so it just didn't even work. Or there are like basic things that like maybe they should have thought of, but really helped them struggle, or made them struggle. And so in last year, or I guess 2017, in 2015, News Corp did a $371 million write-off, which is huge, and they sold it back to some of the employees, and they were basically like, oh, well. And so there's also this great book called Class Clowns, which is a bunch of case studies of how these really smart investors who made billions of dollars in all these other industries were like, oh, we're going to fix education. We're going to make all this money. The technology's ready. Let's do it. And they lost billions of dollars, all of them. So Rupert Murdoch is an example in that book. But there are a bunch of other great examples of companies that have failed in education. And there are many more. This is not, I'm not just sort of cherry picking the losers. No, Blackboard, Chegg, even Chegg. I mean, Chegg is doing okay, but is not great, and is also not a very good business. So what's the common thread in all of these companies? And you know, what can we learn from the mistakes that they're making and the fact that education businesses have just not been very good? To me, the answer is pretty simple, actually. It's that they are building enterprise software, but they're building it for enterprises that don't have that much money and that are even more challenged in how they buy than enterprises, which are sort of normal for-profit businesses. So they have sort of the worst parts of enterprise software, where they have long sales cycles, and it takes a long time to pilot the software, and you have to get buy-in from lots of parties, and you have these centralized decision makers that don't really know about the problems of the users of the software. And so there are all these problems in how it gets bought, and also just the dollar sizes aren't that big. The software is not designed with students in mind, because they're bought with checklists of features and stuff like that that these district purchasers or these, you know, school, you know, centralized buying places buy from. So this just makes the edtech business really hard. And but there's a reason to think that might be changing now. And there's a couple of very specific trends that I'm actually really excited about that I think are going to change this. So the first one is that there's been a dramatic change in the last 4 years in the connectivity in US schools. So in 2013, 30% of US schools were meeting this threshold of 100 kilobits per second, 100 kilobits per second per student connectivity in all of their schools. And today that number is 88%. And that's a really dramatic change. And what happened was the federal government decided that students should have internet in their schools. And so they allocated a few billion dollars through the FCC E-rate program. And they said, we need to get Wi-Fi, we need to get fiber optic connections, and we're just going to make this happen. And it did. And it's actually a pretty cool thing, because some of the problems, like with Amplify or with a bunch of other sort of ed tech over time, has been just basically like, it works great at the office of the company with the fast connection when they're building it, but then when it actually gets deployed in schools and there are hundreds of kids all trying to use it at the same time, it just completely breaks because they don't even have the bandwidth to make it work. So this is a really great sign. Of course, you can do better than that in terms of speeds, but that's sort of a baseline that this nonprofit Education Superhighway has said will be enough to sort of do basic delivery of good educational software. And so we've had a dramatic improvement in that. And the other piece of that puzzle is the devices. So it's not enough to just obviously have connection. You need to have devices. And Chromebooks are the real winners here. So in the last few years, we've gone from 23% of US K-12 students having one-to-one devices to 54%. So not quite as dramatic change, but still a pretty dramatic change. And a lot of the students who don't have one-to-one devices do have access to some sort of computer, maybe laptop cart or something like that. And the cool thing is these Chromebooks, and I think Chromebooks are the best example, but there are some others, are, you know, the battery will last all day, they're rugged, they're cheap, they're like $150, and compared to $800 that you would pay a decade ago per device, it just makes it so much more feasible for schools to be like, we're going to have a device for every student. And then once you have a device and you have good Wi-Fi for every student, it just means that you don't have this concept of like computer time where the kids have to go to the computer lab, or they have to spend 5 minutes booting up and signing in, and three students' Wi-Fi networks isn't working, or their password's not working, or whatever. Like, a lot of these problems that are just basic, but have been impeding the progress of having ed tech in schools for a long time, are getting solved now. And so, basically, my argument is the infrastructure to allow this stuff to happen is here, or is arriving currently, and the cool thing that allows to happen, this is Sanjay, is a totally different method of choosing software and of sort of setting up your class. So in the previous model, you'd have teachers. They get assigned a textbook, or they pick a textbook, and they can't do that much more than pick certain chapters that they want to use from the textbook and stuff like that. But when you have a device for every student, you can say, okay, we're all going to watch this YouTube video now, and we're going to go see this thing on edX, or we're gonna, like, they can mix and match with all these different other tools and other providers, and they don't have to be sort of locked into whatever the school has decided is best for them. And so that creates this choice where students are empowered and teachers are empowered to say, oh, this is gonna be the best tool for my class, and I'm just gonna turn it on. And that's how all consumer software works, But that's not how it's worked in the past. And so that's a really exciting change because it also sets the stage for actually replacing paper textbooks and the whole sort of ecosystem that exists around paper textbooks. So it's not just that students get assigned a textbook. It's they have the workbooks, they have the worksheets, they have the lesson plans that the teachers give. They have the whole sort of system that's provided around it is now sort of replaceable, or at least it's less relevant or necessary than it used to be. There's definitely still value in the sort of the curriculum that a textbook can provide, but the way it's delivered is just not very good. And so the scary thing, though, is actually sort of just moving to a digital future is not, by default, a good thing to happen. So I would say this looks like a great, colorful classroom of kids using computers. However, I think it's a pretty bleak view of the future of classroom technology. And the reason is all the kids are plugged into headphones. They're big dividers between each student. None of them are talking to each other. None of them are looking at each other. They're not using the classroom for what a classroom is really good at, which is getting students to interact, getting students to ask questions of each other, getting teachers to talk to their students. So maybe this is fine if the students are at home and they need to do some work, but this is, to me, a sad vision for the future of classrooms. And I think it's a vision that a lot of entrepreneurs have had, a lot of them have pointed to, and this general idea that we can build sort of AI systems that are gonna tutor and teach the student and adapt to what they know, like that's a good thing, but it's also limited, and it doesn't encourage what you actually want to happen in a classroom, which is the sort of interaction and discussion and stuff like that. And so if we just go along with the way the industry, I think, is going, we're gonna end up like this. And we're not gonna actually be in a sort of shinier future because we adopt digital tools. We're gonna be in a similar one to what we have now, where students sit at their desk, do their worksheet, turn it in, and don't really interact with other people. And so what we need to do is figure out how we avoid that. I just wanna sort of pull up one example from Quizlet, but there are lots of others that I'm gonna talk about. So we built this game called Quizlet Live. And I just did a search on Twitter in real time for Quizlet Live. There's no filters or anything. So in the last few minutes, this one's 20 minutes ago. This is 47 minutes ago. This teacher was periscoping this thing of these students sort of bouncing around playing this game. And you can see all these kids are sort of interacting with each other and talking to each other. They're not plugged in to headphones. They're sort of excitedly talking to each other and discussing problems and stuff like that. So this is not anything prepared. This is just a real-time view of the last few hours of what people are talking about with Quizlet Live. So I guess I should back up and what is Quizlet Live? So Quizlet Live is a game that we built in April of last year that is a real-time classroom game. And what it does is it groups students into teams and it gets them to answer questions together. And the questions are spread out across the different screens of the students. And so they have to work together in order to solve the problems. And they have to communicate with each other to figure out the right answers. And And it also randomly assigns the teams, so and they, the teams have to get together like physically in order to make it work. So it's this really fun game dynamic. It's very collaborative. It also has this sort of healthy competitive angle. And it's this really cool thing we built. And I want to talk a little bit briefly about how we designed it, because I think it's relevant. So we decided in January of last year that we wanted to build a game for a classroom, but we didn't quite know what. And so we set a deadline for 3 weeks from the current date. And we said, OK, we are going to have a game, and we're going to test it in a classroom. And we set up a visit so that we would have something. And we couldn't move the deadline because the kids were expecting us to come. And we would just be there. And whatever it was, we'd see what happens. And I believe this is a picture from that day. We brought this game that was a little bit like Quizlet Live is today. And it took a long time to figure out how to get onto the teams. The kids didn't know what to do for the first two games because there were no real instructions. And like it was just like completely a mess. However, we sort of captured a few moments like this where when the game finally got working and there was this sort of interesting team dynamic happening, there was so much engagement and so much excitement, and the kids were just like, they were learning new material that they'd never seen before, and they were trying to figure out what it was, and there was like the whole like energy level in the room was so much higher than we'd observed in the past, or like in the previous minutes, because they were sort of very active in playing this game and competing with their friends and working with these other students. And so after we had that visit, we were like, okay, we're onto something. And we kept working on it. We added some instructions. We made it a little simpler. We basically set up visits for the next week and the next week. And we set them up basically once a week, sometimes twice a week, where we'd go, we'd test what we had, and iterate for the next week. And that brought us to something that is now used by millions of people, that is the fastest growing thing that we've ever built, and is sort of an exciting model, I think, for how you build something, in that you're understanding really what students want and what, yes?
Did you go to the same school when you were testing things? And if you did the students feel like guinea pigs?
So we went to a bunch of different schools, but we also went back to the same schools maybe twice or three times as we progressed. And you know, the students were excited to try something new. When you tell them that you guys are the first kids in history to ever try this, they're like, "Ooh, this is cool." And you know, like we walk in with Quizlet shirts, and they're like, "Oh, this!" Like they use it already a lot, so they get pretty excited. So this is something that I'm excited about. It's a start for us, but it's the real challenge is what, like I was talking about earlier. You know, I was building for myself in the early days, and I had so much empathy because it was myself. But now, actually, I don't, and our whole team doesn't, because we're professionals and we work in an office and we have all these other responsibilities about keeping the site up and, you know, dealing with all the random things that come in when you have an open content platform. And so you really have to be connected at this level in order to like design this kind of thing, I think. So back to the sort of broader education business. In general, I think on the internet, these open content platforms win over closed content platforms. Closed content platforms include Khan Academy or OCW. And not that and those things are both awesome. It's just that the scale of that you can reach when you have an open platform is just so much higher. And so YouTube today is one of the most powerful learning tools probably in the history of the world. And there's so many interesting videos. There's so many things that kids can learn, students can learn. But there's also lots of cat videos and lots of weird, mean stuff and crazy stuff. And so the challenge is when you have an open thing, it's sort of uncontrollable by definition. And these are some other examples of sort of open-ended systems that that have created a lot of value for people. And of course, the risks are that they're when you build something like this, and Quizlet has all of these things, you have low-quality content, you have inaccurate content, you have stuff with typos, you have stuff that is maliciously wrong, you have all sorts of crazy stuff. You also have copyright violations, you have people who are mean to each other, you have really bad stuff. And an example from Minecraft, which is maybe instructive, is actually the Lego company was basically all set to launch their own version of Minecraft before Minecraft ever came out. They realized what was coming. They built this whole sort of virtual reality system where you could, build your own blocks and create your own worlds and basically do what Minecraft is today. And they got very far along, and then they realized that they had a problem because you could construct the image of a penis in blocks. And they couldn't figure out, with all sorts of machine vision or whatever, how to get this not to show up on the platform. And they were like, we can't launch this because it'll be terrible for our brand when these adults or whoever creates this thing, and a kid will see it, and there'll be this news article, and it'll be all bad. And so they canceled it. And maybe that was the right decision for them, but then Minecraft came out, and it's this huge success, and no one really associates Minecraft with bad things, although there are some bad things probably that happen on the platform. So that's a great example of, YouTube has plenty of similar things. So what I would challenge you guys, if you guys are doing the hackathon thing today, is to build tools that empower people and that help them take an active part in their learning process. A couple great examples. I don't know if you guys still use Piazza. When I was here, we did, and it was great, I thought, because it, Piazza doesn't know the answer to the questions that are being posed on the platform, but it provides this like great platform for discussion where the answers get resolved by students and teachers. Desmos is another great example of a company. They build a graphing calculator but they also have these, so the graphing calculator you can make anything, but they also have these activities, some of which they've built and some of which they've allowed their students and teachers to build, where you can sort of create a model and ask questions about it and interrogate it in real time, and it's very cool. And of course, Scratch is a great example where, it's this open programming system. People can post whatever they want on there, and it doesn't have limits. It doesn't have right answers. And I think there's basically we need more education technology tools where there is no right answer to the questions being posed, or the right answers are not necessarily knowable by the platforms where they're being asked. So that's what I would hope for you guys. It also, from a business perspective, I think this is the kind of thing that is going to succeed because it's succeeded in consumer technology, and it's with the sort of availability of these cheap devices and internet access, the sort of stage is set for students and teachers to adopt their own tools rather than districts to purchase tools and stuff like that. So a lot of change is coming, and I think it's a great time to be building tools. So with that, does anyone have any questions or comments for me? Yeah. So the question is, are teachers going to be replaced by something else? I mean, it depends on what you're trying to achieve. To me, like, there's the value in teachers is in the sort of personal connection they have to students and the way they challenge students, the way they care about students. And an AI system is probably not going to care about them. It might help them a lot. It might teach them a lot of things. But it's not going to, you know, push them to be a better human. I think there's a lot we can do in edtech to take away a lot of the drudgery or a lot of the busy work. And personalized learning, but replacing teachers, I don't think, is a useful goal. Yeah?
So how do you create tools that promote more effective modes of learning, like understanding facts in terms of how you would use those to create effective systems rather than just memorizing what things do?
Mm-hmm. That's a great question. So the question is, how do you create systems that help students not just memorize facts, but understand them in context and in systems. And, you know, that's something that we think about a lot. That's probably one of our biggest challenges. So for Quizlet, a lot of the content is this sort of foundational knowledge that people have to remember, but it's limited in, the modes we have for applying the content and using it in context are we don't really have today. And so for us, that's a big challenge. I think the way we go about that is with this sort of open-ended idea where rather than us knowing the answers to all the questions and having some multiple choice system where we know if you got a right answer or not, or a fill-in-the-blank system or whatever kind of system, the system doesn't necessarily know the right answer to the questions. And you get the students, you get the to give peer feedback, or you get teachers to give feedback. There's other ways you can construct these systems so that they are like, say, like a Google Doc or something like that. Google Docs are a great educational tool where it's literally a blank piece of paper, but it also has these ways for sharing and commenting that actually create really meaningful educational interactions. So I think it's sort of more on that side of the spectrum than systems that sort of ask a question and then determine an answer and then adapt to how you did on that answer to another question that they also know the answer to. Yeah?
You mentioned the global reach of Quizlet. Can you say a bit more about that? But how you reach to other audiences outside the US?
Yeah, so this is something we're just figuring out, which is our international expansion. And so we've been in English only up until about 6 months ago. And so that's obviously sort of the first step in going international. And we're now in 13 languages, which I'm really excited about. We've done a really big push. We've hired a few people that know a lot about localization in languages. So our strategy is that we don't quite know what's going to be effective, and we need to sort of build up a playbook of how we expand. And so we've decided in 2017 to focus on two countries, Brazil and Germany, which is a developed market and a developing market, and try to go as deep into those two countries as possible and learn about how you grow in those countries and what's effective and what's not, and then sort of in the future years use that as a model for expanding around the world. So we've expanded to many languages, but our sort of focus for this year is on a smaller sort of knowable set of places. Yeah.
Oh,
You mentioned that Quizlet works because you engage with the user,
yeah.
And it was user-centric. But those are terms I've been hearing for at least 25 years. So
yeah.
What has prevented other folks from doing it?
Yeah. So, I mean, I don't think it's, no one has done it. The question is, you know, we've been hearing about user-centric design for a long time. I think the, specifically in education technology, it just hasn't really happened. And that's largely because of the money flowing through the system and how it flows through the system, and the fact that EdTech providers spend most of their time talking to district buyers and people that are not the students and teachers. And so they may spend some time doing testing with students, but probably not enough. And that actually is probably part of why they've failed as businesses as well, because they haven't made something that students or teachers would use anyway, even if they, you know, weren't told to use it. And so I think it's more about bringing some of that philosophy that comes more from consumer software than enterprise software into EdTech specifically, which has looked more like enterprise software. Yeah.
So when you collect flashcards, you kind of collect like the nuggets of information that people have harvested through the class. Have you thought of harvesting this information and making some sort of intelligent thing that could answer your questions and like a chatbot, for example?
Mm-hmm. So the question is, have we thought of sort of harvesting all of our user content to create some sort of more intelligent system? And definitely, yes. That's one of the really cool promises, I think, for Quizlet is that we have so much information about how kids are learning and what they're learning, and we can use that to help them. So the trick is, like, we still want it to be a platform where students are expressing what they're trying to do, and we're not telling them here's the next thing to learn necessarily, but we might be able to predict what they're already trying to do and just autofill that in. And then we might also be able to say there's 100,000 other people have learned this exact same thing as you have, and this 20% learned it faster or more effectively this way, and so we'll funnel you through that path. So I think that's the sort of way of building something that is still sort of there for the users to do what they want, but also can use the algorithms and the huge data that we have. Yeah?
Increasingly, there is an issue with student data privacy. FERPA protects student data at educational institutions. COPPA protects minors in any trade situation.
Yeah.
But many of these federal laws have not been constructed with a visibility or a thinking about providers like Quizlet.
Yeah.
Piazza has run into trouble with several educational institutions refusing to allow Piazza to be used on campus recently. Because of such issues, because of their scheme to monetize the data that they're holding. For example, you can imagine that 20 years from now, Quizlet could release the educational records of the then presidential candidate. What are your thoughts about this data privacy?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think there's going to need to be updated legislation probably in the next few years as some of these changes happen. And I also think, we don't have any particular interest in tracking individual students or knowing lots about them. I think we just want to, it's useful to have aggregate data about how people are learning, but the sort of deep personalization of like every interaction and it being tailored exactly to you, I think, is useful, but I think it's also sort of overblown in excitement around the world. So I think, you know, if we can store some of that data for 6 months because it's relevant to the class you're taking or something like that, and then aggregate it after that, I think that's a reasonable sort of balanced approach to something like that. But I do think it requires a lot of effort to manage that data and make sure it gets deleted and stuff like that, and that's something I don't think any companies are very good at, or a lot of companies aren't very good at right now. Yeah?
Content creation, flashcard creation, has Quizlet thought about taking a chunk of text and automatically creating flashcards from them?
Mm-hmm.
For example, you go to Wikipedia, you highlight some text, and boom, flashcards.
Yeah, we're working on something that we're about to release that is like an OCR system, where on your phone you just take a picture of something and it instantly sort of sucks in everything on the page. So I think that kind of thing, especially in an environment where you don't want to type that much, is really useful. Cool. Any other questions? Oh, yeah.
Because you have such a big repository of student data and performance, and you have kids of various age using your platform. I was just wondering if you see any kind of pattern in how people forget stuff. Does that vary from one age to another? Does that vary from one subject to another? Is there any insight?
So the question is, can we, with all our data, can we determine patterns in how people forget stuff across demographics or subjects? And honestly, that's not something we've spent a ton of time on yet. We are only in the last year or so getting really deep into the basic understanding of when exactly people forget stuff and prompting people to look at stuff again. So that's actually probably something that we'd be really excited to work on, and you know, we have a data science team of 3 people now that's just getting started on problems like that. So that's an exciting area for us. And we're also, I mean, maybe a good time to mention we are hiring for that team and other teams. So if this is interesting, then yeah.
We should probably wrap up, but on that note, let's thank Andrew.
Thanks.